first introducing Dr. Michael Hemphill from the College of Charleston. Dr. Hemphill serves as an academic advisor to Chucktown Squash and is a professor at the College of Women's Squash. Dr. Hemphill focused on how our involvement with Chucktown Squash has helped many students from becoming a statistic. Please welcome Dr. Michael Hemphill.
For the past 3 years, it has been a pleasure to work closely with the Chucktown Squash Board of Directors and staff. It has especially been rewarding to work with the Chucktown Squash students, many of whom have joined me on the stage tonight. I would like to tell you just a little bit about these students. They joined the Chucktown Squash program as 5th and 6th grade students from the Sanders-Clyde School. Just this year, we've welcomed students from Burke Middle School as we expand our program. All of our veteran students have successfully advanced into academically rigorous programs, including the Advanced Placement Program at Burke High School, Academic Magnet High School, and the Porter Gow School. They have demonstrated a commitment to excellence in academics and aspirations to attend college. I trust that each of them will reach that goal and hope they will consider the College of Charleston at that time. I want to welcome you all to our Chucktown Talks event featuring guest speaker Maria Toorpakai. Tonight's program is brought to you by Chucktown Squash with generous support from sponsors and individual donors. This program and our event tonight would not be possible without your generosity. Going forward, we will continue to reach out to you as we aim to extend and improve our programs. Our executive director, Lauren Hurd, is accepting in-kind contributions on site here tonight. Thank you all for your support. This year, Chucktown Squash celebrates its 5th anniversary. Through an extensive partnership with the College of Charleston, Chucktown Squash employs a sport-based youth development model unlike any other. We use sports as a force to promote academic excellence among youth, providing a unique blend of physical and intellectual stimulation. The results are promising. For example, the Chucktown Squash approach has proven to be successful in helping our youth advance into academically rigorous high school programs in Charleston County. Additionally, the Charleston County School District and Charleston Promise Neighborhood recently partnered with Chucktown Squash in Charleston's first ever Extended Learning Day program. Through this partnership, youth from Sanders-Clyde School spend an extra 3 hours per school day on the College of Charleston campus. Academic reports from the school district show that the students are improving in their core subject areas and standardized test scores. Research conducted by College of Charleston faculty and students has shown that our youth are developing personal and social responsibility skills and that they feel a sense of belonging to our program. Most important, research suggests that Chucktown Squash participation promotes leadership, high aspirations, and improved academic performance during the school day. Tonight, we invite Maria Toorpakai because she embodies the hopes we have for the kids in Chucktown Squash. Like Maria, our youth have demonstrated the ability to face and overcome adversity. Through their participation in our program, youth can develop a sense of purpose and a sense of place that was so instrumental in the inspiring story that will be told by Maria tonight. Her dream is to be the best squash player in the world and use that as a catalyst to advance international humanitarian causes. After spending a couple of days with her, I am convinced that she will achieve that goal. Among our youth, they dream to be doctors, engineers, executives, and artists, among other things. To achieve these dreams, our youth need to perform well in school, and they need to be on track to attend college. They will need our support along their path. So I want to recognize our partners, because through partnerships, we can make these dreams a reality. I especially want to thank the undergraduate students from the College of Charleston who work with our youth on a daily basis and assist me in my work. I also thank our parents, many of whom have joined us here tonight, and other members from the local community, school teachers, and district administrators. Finally, I thank my College of Charleston colleagues for welcoming our program onto the campus and promoting an atmosphere of diversity and inclusiveness. With these unique partnerships, including business, philanthropy, higher education, and communities, I believe the future of our youth is boundless. At this time, I would like to welcome Zazia Williams back to the podium. Zazia is an 8th grade student at Sanders-Clyde School. She was recently a top performer in the Charleston County School District Spelling Bee. She's been a member of Chucktown Squash for 2 years. Just this week, she submitted her high school applications to the Burke High School Advanced Placement Program, the Charleston County School of the Arts, and Academic Magnet High School. They would all be lucky to have her. Zazia will introduce our keynote speaker.
Anymore. They're all bombed. And
playing sports squash in shorts and skirts. Even in Pakistan and other areas, they don't play squash like that too. So my dad, he educated my mom when he got married. It was an arranged marriage. And this marriage was between such families that they always fight with each other. And my great-grandfather, one of them, he was given the Genghis Khan title during British India. And he was given a horse so he can ride it and cover the whole area. And he keeps running the horse, and the area he covers, that will be his land. And he did cover my dad's grandfather's land too. And that's how the fight started in these two families. And my dad's grandfather, with my mom's grandfather, ended up like my dad's grandfather had to leave to Afghanistan. And he was a very good, you can say, scholar in Quran. Like, he remembered everything and he was teaching everyone. But so my dad comes from a very religious family. And his grandfather was second to King Amanullah in Afghanistan. So my dad, when he was a kid, people thought he was crazy, he's mental. He's not stable, and whatever he tries, sometimes he falls into the well. Sometimes he wants to, play hockey with different things he tries, right? Like climbing the roof and falling from there and beating the kids, how hard you can hit me and it won't hurt me. And there were a lot of things that he can tell me more about. So they put him in mental jail when he was young too. Then he released him after 2-3 days. Mental jail is different. It's like a jail you are stuck with mental people. Then they put him in a school far away from the village because my dad's family has male who are educated, but not female. So my father, in the school, he used to escape from there, go to cinema, theater, and open his collar, and he watched some cowboy film movies. He wants to be a cowboy. He goes back to his village and holds his father's finger. I want a donkey, now. Well, that day, his brother was dead too, like, they were burying him, you know. But he did not understand. He said, I want a donkey. His father bought him a donkey, and he started riding the donkey and whistling. And all over the village he is, and, you know, trying to be a cowboy. When he got older, he met some hippies in Peshawar. You know hippies? He wanted to have jeans and all those stuff. Clean shave, long hair, my dad. And walking without shirt, with jeans, in the middle of the Peshawar market, with all the hippies. He comes back home. People thought that something has happened. He is going more crazy. And then he was away at that time when his father came to know that these people were from Germany and France, these hippies, and they came after him to the village and asked his father that we want him to be a model. And his father says, no, leave the place now and before my son comes or anything. And he won't. My dad wanted to be a movie star. So, and he wants me to now. Like, he tried all his best on me, shaving my head, putting one earring, you know, things like that. I was an experiment for him. So, they write a they arranged a marriage with their rival, the family. And they asked, they thought that his mentalism would go on that family. And that was an arranged marriage. And what happened that my dad decided that I want to educate my wife. They were very unhappy with this situation. They put him in jail, mental jail. My mom met him a few times in the jail. And he, before that, before putting him into jail, they tied him up without clothes into a four-wall room which had no roof. It was a mud room and locked. And even if he used to go to the washroom, like outside, I mean, it was not washroom, his cousins were going with him with guns, and his family was very upset, like with his thinking, revolutionary thinking, what he wanted to do. So they put him in jail after that. He escaped from there. He broke his leg, his jaw. He has, on one side, he doesn't have his fake teeth. So he came to village with gun. He was able to escape with my mom. And then they came to Southwaziristan. My mom gave birth to all the children without any help or anyone. And I remember when my younger brother was born, after some few hours she was working in the house. So my dad educated my mom. He was started going out and learning from different schools and places, asking professors, whoever he meets, right? He heard the story about some president of USA who was selling these peanuts outside. And he was uneducated, and whenever he sees someone who has knowledge, he will ask something. So that's when he thought that, you know, I can do something like that too. He went to every person he saw that he has knowledge, he asked something and brought it to my mom. He educated my mom, my sister. My mom did her essay, her master's, her bachelor's, her MA examinations. She was teaching in the local schools in the tribal areas, and then she became principal, and she served as assistant director of education. My sister, she was a great educator from a young age. My dad, he spent all his time with children. He had no friends. Just because he thought, why all these people spend time training their quails, their pigeons, or roosters for fights? I should spend more time on my children rather than doing that, this, and they should too. And I should prepare my children for biggest fight. And he spent all his life with us. And today my sister is in parliament. She just got elected. We live the same simple life, same way, didn't change anything. Only thing is that our position, our mentality, and our, you know, God gifted us. And today I'm a squash player. I grew up as a tomboy. That was my dad's support. If he was not, he was very strict like any other man, I would be just like any other girl who was in his family. Married by now, for sure. Many kids. But that was not for me. Everyone, I believe, comes with skills, comes with a destiny. They just have to raise their voice, what they want to do. I asked many times my dad and mom, they didn't listen. I said I want to be like my brother. And one day they were not home. In the age of four, I picked up all my girly clothes and burned them outside. And I was literally dancing by the fire. My mom screams all of a sudden.
She comes in, and my dad laughed at him. He said, "What happened to him?" And I said, "I don't want this. I want to be like this." And he said, "Okay, your name is Chengiz Khan from now on." So we soon shift to another area, to North Waziristan. And I had a better life there. Nobody knew me. I shared that, playing with boys, jumping from one, into the pit of the mountains, and going for hunting, running out after donkeys. There was a place I used to lock all the donkeys there and run after them all the time. So that was a lot of fun for me. And I was very athletic. I was very angry. My dad used to put me always in work. So he used to give me an axe so I can chop all the wood and bring water, big gallons of water all the time from far away in a one-wheel cart. So all the things that boys do outside, I used to bring grocery, hanging by the public bus or the transport, just like any other boys or men, go to the market. Sometimes I bring grocery too. Once a week, I bring a movie cassette too. My dad wants to watch old Indian movies or some good action English movies. So once a week, we used to get this treat after hard working days of studies. It was more about studies that time. When we came to Peshawar, and it was a very hard time too, because my dad knows, when he was educating my mom and sister, I was very young. He was very under pressure. People put lots of pressure on him, and he had to move from one area to another. I was 10 years old when I learned how to use a gun. And I used to keep a gun when I was 10 in house. When my dad was away, I used to keep the gun. My brother was a little bit different. I shot firing on some people too, actually. I was sitting on top of a wall, and there were fields, and there were a little bit far, there was mountains. So some guys were coming from the road, and they just said some bad words, and I was like, "Give me the gun!" And I was like, I pointed to them, and then they started running as real gun. And when I shot them in the air, they were like all running, left, leaving their stuff. And then I came to, and I was riding bicycle in those areas too, bringing all like eggs and vegetables from the farms and things. So in Peshawar, when I came, I had a lot of fights too with boys all the time, who was bleeding. I wasn't very beauty conscious. So when I had a huge fight with some guys, I was all bleeding and got 12 to 13 stitches in my head. And my dad was holding my hand while I was away, and I saw this guy again and started running after him with all the blood on my face. Then my dad was worried about me, like what we should do with this girl. Like, she is now 12 years old. She has, what is her future? We just can't say, stop at home, don't do anything. He thought maybe she is at home. Just came in his mind, I'm not stable like I'm huge physically, big, right? And very angry, aggressive, and I want something, I want it. So he thought that, okay, there are sports in Peshawar. He took me to the sports stadium, and that's how we learned. I started playing weightlifting with the name of Chengiz Khan. And I went to a competition with some boys. We were all lying down on the floor, everyone. And then do the weightlifting competition, like putting white powder on the head and, getting ready and everything. So excited. And I won the championship in boys. Came back, I said I want to play squash because squash is very big in Pakistan. And I like the idea. I didn't know that big at that time. I like the rackets, I like the outfit, I like the energy that you just have to go for the ball. And I said, I want to play. And that's how I started playing squash. After that, after 1 month, when I started, people came to know about me that I'm a girl. And after that, it was how they came to know about me. I was actually this director of academy who was very happy to have me there. And he knew that I'm a girl because I had to be the member of academy and I had to give him my certificate, birth certificate. And he was the one who awarded me Jonathan Powers Squash to this racket. So I started playing squash after 1 month when he visited the academy and said, well, how is this girl doing? And all the stuff, there's no girl. And he said, no, there's a girl. And he came to the squash and pointed to me, that's a girl. After that, everybody knew that's a girl. Everybody wants to see who is this girl. And I'm an angry person, very angry person at that time. Walking the court, all my knees were bleeding when I was playing squash, just jumping on people, I was getting the ball. So people were not responding very well. All the boys, people started bullying. You know, bullying, you know, like calling me names and not staring at me and laughing at me and calling everything they could do. So sometimes when I'm walking on the way and the horse cart is walking fast, this is snapping that on my way. So, and I didn't feel secure either because some men, when I was coming afternoon times, it was not safe for me. Some bad people, some bad guys who, you know, hold my hand like, and talking really bad, and I just want to run away and I hit them with my racket, but you know, like it was very bad experiences for me. Such experiences happened many times. I escaped from many people, so it was not safe. It's a long story, make it short. So my dad, I knew my dad is not able to stop those people. There are a lot of people. I had to take a step. What I want to do, when I said I want to play squash every day, early morning I have to go. I lock myself in squash court and play for hours and hours and hours. And that paid me off that I became Pakistan number one at a very young age, and then I went to different countries. I played big tournaments, international tournaments. And I started coming, it came in all the news and everything, and I got these letters and a phone call to that time that this is not right, and very, very, very bad phone call to my dad. At that time I knew that I love my dad so much. I never want to be the reason of dishonor for him. If someone kidnaps a girl, that's a huge dishonor. At one point I was even thinking to keep a pill with me. So it was very hard for me to, or gun with me. If someone attacks you, I can shoot myself or eat a pill or something. I was young at that time, I was 16, I was thinking what to do, and that was all coming in my mind. But I stopped playing squash, I was in my room, at home for 1 month or something, and I said, getting depression. But I started playing in my room just without thinking what would happen. Just started playing. Today, I have the best, I know I have, like Jonathan says to me and everyone, I have a very unique hitting style. I have a lot of good control on squash ball, and the game is more imaginary. I started playing, imagining squash ball, playing in squash ball, but it was only this small space, playing ball like this. And all of a sudden I came the idea to even some people, some season as squash coach part time, putting the demand that I would play myself and train in the tournaments. Did it here for 3.5 years. And I got this email from Jonathan, and he said, it was very, that was the first time after 3.5 years that I heard this message. After when I hear this message, I get this message in the evening time. And that night at 10 o'clock, I get dengue fever. And I'm on the floor, and I don't know what's happening to me. It was hard 1 week. Doctors were saying that, you know, lots of people are dying from dengue. No treatment. Luckily, I survived. And after dengue fever, I don't remember if I ever got an email from Jonathan. I do not remember anything. And I doing the same, like, I thought that I could apply for U.S. visa. I applied for U.S. visa and came to a tournament in Delaware. For 6 days, I had a stay. I stayed there for 6 days, for 5 days, but I was worried where I'm going to go, because U.S., I did not know about this state and this country that much. Don't know anyone. I have no brother or no father here. No one. I don't have money. I don't have anything. It's just 1 way ticket. My dad is, I called my dad from someone else's phone, and I said, I'm coming, I don't know what to do. And he said, stay there, wait. And then he, after some time, he found someone, his friend. Luckily, some guy came to our house and, you know, talking. He said, I know someone in the U.S. I know a friend who knows someone in the U.S. So my dad's, that guy, his friend was in the U.S. and he called me and he said, call me uncle. And when you want to come, I said, nah. That's the guy I'm visiting tomorrow in South Carolina, in North Carolina, tomorrow. That's the family I'm visiting tomorrow. Wonderful time with them. Jonathan Power. All of a sudden, I realized that there was a Jonathan Power in after a month. I don't know how come I didn't remember anything. And he said, I called him and he said, yes, I am Jonathan. Till that time, I was like thinking if he is or he's not. He said, yes, I am. Come over. Your visa is done. And that's how I ended up in Toronto, Canada. I know our areas, I know the world, what's happening everywhere. The whole world is affected with terrorism, with negativity, with so much of hate, that this world that God created, that is His land. But we are fighting for it. Today, I want my friends from US, from Canada to come visit Pakistan and they can go freely and discover this beautiful land. But it's impossible even for myself. And those kind of things bother me a lot. And I see goes back. I crossed this bridge. It was fearful. Like I didn't know what to do. But I just kept going with my vision. I said, I can see that beautiful squash court that I'm playing and all the people are clapping and I'm winning this tournament. That was only in my mind. But all the things were happening. My friends, lots of friends from the tribal areas. Sometimes I met them in 2009, 2008, 2007, something like that. They were in horrible position. Some of them are married in 14, age 14, 15. Lots of girls, they were crying in front of me. They don't want to get married. Lots of incidents happened like this. It's in my mind. Some girls lost their brothers to terrorism. My own friends. and I'm left with nothing. And that gave me that I have to do something. I got a, you know, God gave me a chance. I'm alive, I'm here, and I can do a lot. Maybe God is telling me that I have to do something. And I, as I said, I'm the only one who could cross this bridge and could come that far. And maybe if I'm not there, if I don't do it, it's going to take a long time for any other girl to do this, especially when they don't have such power. These areas that I come from, Waziristan, I want to share some poetry from my dad. And he loves so much these areas. And he, this was his vision, to educate women, to empower women, to help these people. They do drugs, there is gun culture, and he doesn't like that. There is always, you kill my brother, I will kill your brother. You kill two, I will kill two. It's things like that, and he does not like that. So, here's my dad, his name is Shams. My dad's name is Shams, and he used his name in his poetry too. Autumn has started, and I see its ominous wings. Spring comes rarely, I see only afflictions. Seldom come now. Afflictions are everywhere. My villages are destroyed, houses are left behind. Tears are shedding from my beautiful eyes. Relationships are a matter of past. My school is no more there. The village water spot is deserted. I only see bombs everywhere. Autumn has started and I see its ominous winds. Spring comes rarely, I see only afflictions. Where have our young girls gone who used to carry firewood on their heads? Our proudly erected turbans have suffered disgrace, I see wounds. Where have the gatherings and groups of happy young men gone? Autumn has started and I see its ominous wings. Spring comes early, I see only afflictions. There used to be the peaks of lofty mountains. There used to be the tall trees. Water used to gush in the streams. Rains used to shower. You used to pick berries. Now I see only memories. Autumn has started and I see ominous wings. Spring comes early. I see only afflictions. Cattle used to wander freely. You used to milk them at night. I would eat white butter and ghee prepared by you. You would give me buttermilk to drink. Now I see only empty bowls. Autumn has started and I see its ominous winds. Spring comes rarely, I see only afflictions. Oh, pomegranate. You are one, he's saying pomegranate from Waziristan. He says, oh pomegranate, you are one. Waziristan, you are one. While there are many patients for you, I have recognized you as my friend, but I am confronted with many enemies. Autumn has started and I see its ominous winds. Spring comes lately, I see only afflictions. My elders are bargainers. My officials are bargainers. The only thing they can see is money. This was to happen, and this will keep happening if they don't see my punitive action. I see tricks everywhere due to the net spread by the hunter. Autumn has started and I see its ominous winds. Spring comes early, I see only afflictions. Outsiders see treasures on my beautiful land. I did not bother to learn skills. Now I am shocked. This is a young kid that is talking about Waziristan. I did not bother to learn skills. Now I am shocked. I did not used to read books. Now I see walls everywhere. Autumn has started and I see it ominous winds. Spring comes early. I see only affliction. What was past forget it. That's what now my dad is telling the kid. What was past, forget it. Now stand up and take your pen and book. Stop playing with pigeons. Make peace, oh my village. When I see your courage, I see lofty mountains. Autumn has started, and I see its ominous wind. Spring comes early, I see only affliction. Oh, chance. The kid is talking to my dad. Oh, chance means, oh, teacher. Joys are over, you never advised me about it. What kind of teacher you are? Now I am wailing in anguish. My beloved is destroyed, I am destroyed, now I see fires. I think that's all. So, yeah, that's what my dad wrote about those people. That young kids who did not want to study, wanted to play with pigeons and quails and cockfighting. And they are asking their elders, who are barbarians. And they asked their elders, because they respected them as a teacher, that why you didn't advise me to prepare myself to read and write and learn. Today there is war everywhere. And he's saying that, like, pomegranate is very healthy for you. And patience, it's good for patience. And that's what he said, that that's a loss of war is going, lots of people want one pomegranate. There's only one Uzbekistan. There are lots of patients that they want Uzbekistan. So it's still this way. So my dad loves Pakistan. He wants to stay there. He wants to work for the people. He knows that drugs is a huge problem. I just announced a drug hospital, and I will support this. We're gonna do fundraiser for this. We're going to build this thing in Peshawar. It is under process. We are asking for land and everything. So this through drugs we can control a lot of problems too. Lots of men are drug addicts and. They are used for militancy too, for Talibanization and suicide bombing. So to control that power, we need to work on the drug addicts, and it's important. And they are creating domestic violence too. When it comes to education, definitely my goal is to take education back, sports and skills to the people, so they can learn, they can stay healthy, positive, just like me now I am. When I'm angry, I go to squash court. So that's the thing I want. I want them to take pen, rackets, bags, footballs instead of guns and, fighting or bombs. And at the end, I want you all to pray with me for this, all the people who lost their loved ones, who were innocent, who were pure souls, good human beings, who died because of injustice, in this terrorism. My sorrow, my pure thoughts and love, in my prayers. Is with all those people, and I deeply feel I want to extend my condolences to that young soldier, Nathan, Captain Nathan, who died in the incident, in the attack on Parliament Hill in Ottawa. And I always say that. Now I got a permanent residency in Canada, so I can say that I'm half Canadian. And I think, when you belong to you, you're born from one mother. She loves you so much, and you care for her, you respect her, you look after her. And that's what I think. If some other mother looks after you well, cares about you, you give her the same love. And that's what I think. The love I could give to Pakistan, same love I give to Canada. And I think we Canadian people don't deserve that kind of attacks, or any other country, any other people. So I love you all, and thank you, and be with me. Thank you.
Thank you.